أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you so much for joining us, your brother in Islam, Muhammad West. This part 4 of our series, The Hardest Hour, where we look at the difficulties that this Ummah has faced over the last 1400 years and how we came through it. And this of course is to give us strength and encouragement that this is our test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put us in this chapter of the Ummah, and it's what we're going to do to overcome, so that in 100 years, 200 years time, when generations write about this group of people, what are they going to say about us? Alhamdulillah, how we come through these difficulties. Today's lecture is entitled The Heroes of the South, and it's going to be a little bit of South Africa focused. We are of course here in South Africa. I'm recording here in the Algeem studios. One of the reasons why I think we leave Algeem, you know, one of the letters of the Arabic, it's referring to Janub, which is south, and the people of the south, because we are here at the tip of Africa. And I know many of you, especially with AlKauthar, you are watching from all over the world. I know our listener base from Boorhaanol Islam Masjid as well, you've reached many parts of the world. So if you feel a little out, don't feel so. Especially if you come from countries like Australia or Indonesia, Sri Lanka, your countries, India, will be mentioned in our lecture today, and England as well. You have a big part to play. There's going to be a bit of colonization. So some of you are colonizers and some of you are colonized, wherever you are fit in the story, walhamdulillah. So South Africa, we've had a Muslim community here for about 350 years now. The oldest masjid is about 200 years in South Africa, and perhaps even the first masjid in the southern hemisphere of the world, alhamdulillah, some accounts. And it has gone through such a traumatic history, the community here in South Africa, that if you look at the challenges it had faced, under, you know, in spite of all calculations, in spite of all rational thinking, this community should not have survived. Islam should have become extinct here because of all these challenges that it went through. But alhamdulillah, it's a miracle that we are here, and it's a thriving community, and it's a proud Muslim community for many, many centuries. And alhamdulillah, I would like to talk through the history and how we got here. And for us, South Africans, when you look through this presentation, you will see that, subhanAllah, there were so many moments where this community could have disappeared. But it survived and it continued on for the next generation. And as we go through our own challenge now with this disease, mosques being closed, Ramadan, we won't be able to celebrate it together in the masjid. How do we survive for the next generation? And that's what's important for us. So a little bit of history. Before South Africa was discovered or colonized by the European forces, the people that lived here in Cape Town, in the western side of South Africa, the southern western side, the blue area on the map, they were called the Khoisan people. This is the indigenous people of this country, and perhaps of the oldest civilizations in the world. If you look at the skulls and the traditions that were here, I mean, many, many thousands of years these people have lived in this area, and they occupied more the southwestern side of South Africa. We have then in the central part a bit of a desert, and so not much civilization in the central part. And then we had towards the eastern side of South Africa, Durban and Natal kind of area. And if you look at this map more clearly, the red side, these are your black Africans, and it's imagined or it's thought that these were ethnic people that came from Central Africa, from Congo and these kind of countries. They migrated south and they set up African kingdoms. So the Khoisan people of the West are a bit different to the African, African people that came from Central Africa. And, you know, even within the African population, you find very, you know, the Zulu and the Khoza people, you find very interesting practices in their culture that hints at an Islamic influence. You have, for example, circumcision amongst them, which is a very Islamic kind of tradition. Their males go through a process of circumcision. You find labola, which is a kind of a dowry that is paid to the bride and her family on marriage. So a lot of these kind of nuances in the eating habits as well, that is almost Islamic in its customs. And so we pray that alhamdulillah there might have been some influence between these customs and Islam, and inshallah to be revived once again. Now moving to our brothers in Europe. Around 1492, we need to do a series on that. It is one of the saddest years in our history. That is the fall of Andalusia. So Muslims ruled in Spain and Portugal, the Iberian Peninsula, for 800 years. Muslims were in Spain longer than Europeans have been in America, North America. That's how long we ruled, survived as a civilization in Andalusia. And it was the most advanced country in all of Europe. Many of the kings of Europe sent their children to study at universities under Muslim tutors and lecturers, advancements in science and technology. But of course, it was not meant to endure. And 1492, this was when the last Muslim kingdom of Granada came to an end, and the Muslims were expelled. And this began really the flourishing. It coincided with when Europe began to ascend. And so Spain, become Christian Spain, is regarded as the first colonial power because they had the ships and had the technology to spread around the world. Vasco da Gama, many of us would have known, a great explorer. They traveled around the world and they, you know, discovered many countries. Of course, we know that there were people living there, and then they enforced their dominance and actually colonized these countries. And a very important part of history that's missing is to say, where did Spain get this technology? This technology came from the Islamic heritage that was there. Muslims were the advanced and most sophisticated civilization during the Dark Ages of Europe. And so when the Spanish Christians conquered Spain, they obviously inherited this technology, and then they used that to further their own objectives. Very interestingly, 1492 is another very famous year. If you're from America, you will know that is the year where Christopher Columbus discovers America. Where did he get his ships from? From Isabel and Ferdinand of Spain, the king and queen of Spain who conquered Granada. So it's amazing. The same people that at the very same year that they conquered the Muslim state of Granada was the same year they actually financed and gave the technology to Christopher Columbus to eventually sail towards America, and he discovered the New World. Alright, we fast forward 100 years. So for the next 100 years, Spain will really dominate the world stage. They will use their technology and they will conquer, you know, South America. Many of the South American countries have a long history with the Spanish Empire. And they obviously sailed all the way to the Philippines and many parts of the world and during the Age of Discovery. At that time, you know, a hundred years or so later, the other colonial European powers begin to become stronger, and they also want to get in, you know, get a piece of the pie, so to speak. And one of the small countries, Holland Dutch is a very small, the Netherlands, very small country, but it wanted to also exert its authority, and it wanted to so the Spanish had a monopoly on the spices, the spice trade of India and the Philippines and Indonesia, and so the Dutch wanted to get in on this market, and so they formed what is the first public listed company in the world. A public company, what is that? You see in the stock exchange, people are buying, you know, you can go today and you can buy, think of the biggest companies in the world, Microsoft, whatever it might be, you can buy a piece of that company on the stock exchange. And so the Dutch came up with this idea that you could buy a share in a company called the Dutch East Indian Company, and this company would then have ships, would go to India, buy spices, would bring it back to Europe, and whatever profit it made, you got your share in its profitability. And that was the idea. And so this company, you know, had a fleet of its own. So this is external to the government. It had its own fleet, and it sailed, you know, from Europe all the way to, its objective was Malaysia, Indonesia, and these very spice-rich countries. And to do this long voyage, they actually went around Africa. And if you know the map of Africa, you'd find that South Africa is right at the bottom here. In Cape Town in particular, it's where Africa comes to an end, the bottom of Africa. And so they set up a post here, set up a little settlement, a castle, and that's where the ships would stop over and replenish and then move on. This was 1652, right? So this is about 150 years after Spain was beginning to colonize the world. And of course, when the Europeans arrived in Cape Town, they found the Khoisan and the people that were living here. We know what basically happens to them. The Europeans, at that time, didn't play very nicely with the indigenous people, and they completely, you know, either wiped them out or basically enslaved them and conquered the entire Cape area and made this land of Cape Town their colony. And they would use it, as we said, to where ships would come around and they would replenish and they would move onwards to Malaysia and Indonesia in particular, because they colonized those areas. So if you look at the maps here, Indonesia, Madagascar, Yemen, these were countries that the Dutch had some kind of presence in them, India as well for some time. And they would, you know, naturally, when they came to these areas who were a little more sophisticated than South Africa, there was resistance. And what do we find in common with many of these lands? These were Muslim lands. So we had Muslims that are now being, the Muslim Ummah is being confronted for the first time with an enemy of this nature. People coming from all the way from Europe with advanced technology and conquering the lands. And naturally, there was resistance. And there was a jihad. I mean, a jihad fought against these colonizers, 100% legitimate jihad. But of course, due to the superiority of their technology, and it's sad that we lost our way, that we were so far behind after being in the lead that we had no resistance. These people could walk into our countries with a handful of ships versus a massive population. They could conquer our countries from Africa, all of Africa, Asia, South America. All of these countries were colonized by Europe, different European kingdoms, and the people had no resistance, and they enslaved en masse millions and millions of people. And the Dutch in particular, what they did was they used South Africa, they used Cape Town, very much like Britain would use Australia as a penal colony. So when they would conquer a land, all those people that fought against them, so the Muslims in Indonesia, Malaysia, Sri Lanka, fighting against the Dutch colonizer, the Dutch beat them, they take these people and they dump them in Cape Town as a penal colony. Cape Town is like at the end of the world, basically, you know, in the middle, far, far away, at the edge of civilization. You basically come here to die. This place was a place of torment. It wasn't a place, they didn't have much agriculture here. It wasn't a very prosperous land. It was purely a place where you would dump your prisoners and your shipping people would come by, replenish, and they would move on. Not much meant to develop this land. And so this is also, but this, the positive side of it is they brought Islam with them. Because they bring these Muslim mujahideen that were defeated, they brought them to South Africa, and these amazing people brought with them the Islam, and they kept the Islam with them. And so we see the first Muslim community beginning to develop towards the end of the 17th century, 1690, the 1700s or 18th century is the beginning of Islam here in South Africa. These mujahideen, these were highly educated people. These were not just your slaves. These were ulama. These were princes and kings and judges, qadis that were being brought here as a form of suppressing them and keeping them away and exile away from their homelands. And so one of the first, you know, there's a place just outside of Cape Town, Makassar, that is the first. And in fact, Makassar is a Malaysian word. It's called Makassar because this was the first farm land in which Muslims actually lived, and they were able to practice their deen. It was still illegal to be a Muslim. No masjids allowed, no tarawih, no open display of your religion. And I mean, many of us experienced that. This is what was happening here. And the Muslims would sort of secretly teach their deen and teach Islam to the next generation in this very, very difficult and hostile environment. For 100 years, the Dutch wielded complete authority over the land here in Cape Town, the Khoisan people being subjugated severely, and those exiled prisoners and slaves being brought from all over the world having their own community. So we have a very strange kind of community here in Cape Town during the 1700s at that time. The Muslim community, we have, there's so many amazing people, but we want to mention two amazing heroes by name. One of our founding fathers of Islam is called Sheikh Yusuf of Makassar. Sheikh Yusuf, about him, he was Sheikh Yusuf of Makassar. We call him of the awliya. And you know, while no one knows who the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are, when we look at what these people sacrificed and what is the legacy they left behind, there's no other term but to hope that these are very close friends and dear people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh Yusuf, rahimallah, you know, he was brought here from Indonesia. He was a judge. He had spent 20 years in Yemen, in the Middle East, studying, learning to be a judge. And he comes home to his land in Indonesia and he finds it, you know, under attack by these foreign invaders. And he is captured and he is sent to Cape Town as a prisoner here in South Africa at the age of 67. So an old man, in 1694, he's brought here and he lives for 5 years on a farm outside of Cape Town. So his job, I mean, the only reason they brought him here was so that he could die a very obscure death. But he came here and he started the first Islamic movement, as you will, some Muslims that found that there's a sheikh, there's an imam, a highly qualified scholar, people left and came to him to learn and to study very much in secret. And that's, he only spent about 5 years in that area before he passed away, Sheikh Yusuf Rahimullah. And so that was the beginning nature of under Sheikh Yusuf Rahimullah. Then we have another great imam, Tuan Guru, that we refer to. Tuan Guru actually means Mr. Teacher, or our the teacher. And but he comes about 100 years after Sheikh Yusuf. So imagine this, Sheikh Yusuf starts a community outside of Cape Town, a very much a rebel community that are teaching the Islam underground. We have no masjid, we have no salah facilities. We just have a tradition of a sheikh teaching a group of students about Islam, teaching them the basics. He passes away, and this tradition gets passed on from family to family, very undercover. It is still illegal to be a Muslim under the Dutch rule. And these different ulama come down, and they find this community just surviving, hanging on by a thread here at the end of the world. The next man to take Islam forward here in this country is, as we said, Imam Tuan Guru, or his name is Abdullah, Abdul Qadi Abdul Salam, that's his actual name. He was a prince from one of the sultanates of, you know, Indonesia's many islands. It wasn't one country, each island was its own kingdom. So this was a prince, a young man who grew up, you know, we could think in the lap of luxury, but he was educated, Hafidh al-Quran. He studied in the madrasa, in the ulum, and he rises up to become of the ruling class of his sultanate, of his little island. But of course, his island would become invaded by the Dutch, and he would resist them. And then, subhanAllah, you know, at the age of 80, you know, or rather at, you know, at the age of 70, he is arrested by the Dutch because he tries to get them out through he's accused of conspiring with the British to get the Dutch out of his country. But he is arrested, and he comes in his 69, 70 years old. He's brought from his homeland to Cape Town as a prisoner. This is a man who's married, he has children, he has a life in Indonesia. He's taken away from all of that. They didn't even allow him to bring his Quran with him. I mean, they didn't even allow him to bring a book with him. So they put him on the ship and they dump him here, of all places, Robben Island. Robben Island is very famous because the most famous prisoner there is Nelson Mandela, founding father of the new South Africa. What's amazing is when those prisoners, Nelson Mandela and those prisoners, came to Robben Island, they found already graves of the first inmates, and those first inmates were Muslim Mujahideen, the very first people to fight oppression in this country, to fight against racism, to fight against one group colonizing another, were the Muslimin, those who said La ilaha illallah. And we take great pride that we were the first people to be in Robben Island as prisoners. So Sheikh Yusuf, or rather Sheikh Tuan Guru, in Robben Island for 13 years, now a man that is in his 70s, being locked up on this island, he's lost his family, he's lost his position, he's lost his home, and he sits there in isolation. And he is using, you know, this time, and it's a harsh treatment. We know we have letters of Sheikh Tuan Guru writing about his time in that isolation. And he speaks about the Imam al-Mazloom, the oppressed Imam, the Imam that has been tortured and has been abused so much in that. But he uses this time not to be a broken man. What he does in his isolation is he says, look, they even took my Quran away from me, so I will write a Quran from memory. And he wrote in his isolation in prison a few Quran masahif from memory. He also wrote a book about the basics of Islam. Now one may ask, for whom is this, O Sheikh? You are in your 70s, you basically have a life sentence in jail, you're never going to leave this land. And he wrote it nonetheless, for whoever it might be. And he wrote it, he wrote the Quran, and he wrote a number of books. And then at the age of 80, 81, he's finally released from prison. We would think an old man, a man that has not much left to live. But he comes now to Cape Town. So Robben Island is a little island outside of Cape Town. He's released. He comes to mainland Cape Town, not allowed to go home. And he's now part of the community in Cape Town. And the first thing the Imam wants to do is he wants to establish a madrasa. Not allowed to have a masjid. Masjid is illegal. Just a school to teach people to recite the Quran. And so he begins. There's a lady, Corridon of Ceylon. Ceylon is Sri Lanka. So if you're Sri Lankans here, you have a very big part in our history. Sheikh Yusuf, Sheikh Tuan Guru were from Indonesia. The Sri Lankans also had a big part in our history. This amazing lady, her parents were slaves. Right? So Qaradan, she's a Muslim lady, her parents were slaves, and they were able to buy their freedom. They worked their whole lives, earned enough money, purchased themselves to be free. And then they had a daughter called Qaradan. And the only thing that, the only position she had was a little house, yeah, in the middle of what we call Buka. And she allowed, now the Sheikh is being released from prison, Sheikh Tuanguru. He comes out of prison, he wants to set up a madrasa. She says, you know what, Sheikh, you can use a part of my house as the beginning of a madrasa. This is the first madrasa in South Africa. And the Sheikh uses it as his madrasa in Dorp Street. And for the first time, slaves who could never read or write had the opportunity to come for free to learn knowledge. The Sheikh said, I will teach you to read or write Arabic. You can learn, of course, his objective is for them to recite the Quran. But anyone, even non-Muslim who wanted to read, you are welcome to come. And this was an amazing thing because at that time, the slaves only saw the master class as being able to read. And now you found people that had our color, that were dark-skinned, could read and had a history, had a civilization, were part of a much bigger thing. It gave Izzah and it gave the oppressed people something to hope for. You found a man that had not power, so to say, but he had Izzah, he had honor. Also, the Muslims, of course, did not drink. They did not, they had a very strict code of living, which gave them a skill, which gave them a position in, you know, people always recognize goodness. Even in the worst of situations, you recognize something which is beautiful and good. And so the Sheikh begins forming his madrasa. At that time, he establishes the madrasa. The British are able to defeat the Dutch. So the Europeans are doing their own fighting and the Dutch are defeated by the British. And all the colonies of Holland falls under Britain. And so Cape Town as well becomes part of Britain, the great British Empire. And the British were, for all the negative things we could say about them, they were a lot better in terms of their relationship with Islam than the Dutch. And they made Islam open, it was a religion that was not illegal. And immediately, the Sheikh is in his 80s. And he petitions the British, allow me to build a mosque. And so the British allow the Muslims to have their first masjid. And this sister, mashallah, what a place she has in Jannah, bi'idhnillah. The sister Qaradan, remember, we said she allowed them to use her house as the first madrasa. She donates her house as the masjid. So our Awwal Masjid, it's called Awwal Masjid, first masjid, definitely in South Africa, but even possibly one of the first masjids in the whole Southern Hemisphere. This, we could say, almost slave lady, the only position she had, she gave this house up lillah to establish this masjid. And this is towards the end of the 18th century, so for the last 250 years that masjid has been intact, and it's the first masjid here in South Africa. What's also what's amazing is that masjid, as I said, is still here today, and all the other mosques in the area follows on from that. That sadaqah al-jariyah that you could think. Even before the masjid was established, there was no masjid, but the Muslims still had a secret way, a jumu'ah in a quarry, in the outside of in an open field or mine area, they would have a jumu'ah. And today, alhamdulillah, on that land, there is a masjid jumu'ah as well. The Jamia Mosque is there as well. So the Muslims try to keep the Islam intact without a masjid, but now, alhamdulillah, towards the end of the 18th century, Tuanguru rahimahullah is able to not only have a madrasa, he now also has this Awwal masjid, which is now established. The Imam, so after he establishes the masjid in 1797, 10 years later, basically, the Imam passes away. So he had 10 years to establish his madrasa, establish his masjid, and from that is a blueprint for other mosques and madrasas to now begin. Now Muslims all over the community are able to build their own mosques and their own madrasas, and a lot of the learnings and teachings of Sheikh Tuanguru's, the Mus'haf that he wrote, the books that he wrote were copied, and this is how for many generations kids would learn the Islam. In fact, our grandparents, if you looked at the way they recited, Alif Dittas, this is how the Malaysians still today recited the Quran. So it is taken with Malaysian culture, Malaysian ways of learning. Many of the rituals that we have here are based on how Islam was taught in Malaysia. If you come to South Africa, you find, so far away from Malaysia, but a lot of it is still, or Indonesia, it is still part and parcel of this culture. And for us, we reflect at a time when our mosques are We're not able to go to the mosques. We're not able to go to the imam, basically. It's up to every individual to now be the imam of his masjid, to take what little knowledge we know and ensure we are teaching our kids and passing on our traditions. But in these difficult experiences, we can either become despondent and lost, or we can try and get through it and survive and thrive. You know, what's amazing is, I think of a man, just imagine Sheikh Tuanguru Rahimullah. 69 years he's been serving Allah, living in his land, fighting the good fight jihad, and he loses and he gets taken as a prisoner. You and me, we might have said, look, 70, not much to live. You might have become even angry with Allah. Ya Allah, why did you do this? I've lost everything. After serving you, you've taken my family away from me. And you put me in jail for 13 years in this horrible prison. And instead of being a broken man, instead of being angry, he uses this time positively. And he comes to this foreign city and he said, well, I will start from scratch. He came from a land which had many mosques, very learned people, Hafiz al-Quran. This is a highly educated professor and he's coming to teach slaves Alif Ba Ta. Why? Someone might have asked him, what are you hoping to achieve by this? He doesn't know. He didn't get to see that 315 years later, we'll be producing these videos. We're going all the way to Australia, the same colonizer, England. You will get this video as well, subhanAllah. He could not have imagined that his teaching would be that we would have in South Africa over 1,000 masajid. This is to the man's credit, rahimullah, and all those people that have contributed, that he planted the seed. And even though you and I, we won't get to see what that seed will become, don't underestimate Allah. You do a good thing. You plant that seed, you make the niyyah sincere, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do in His own way, will put barakah in it, and it will thrive. And so subhanallah, this community, we owe so much to these founding fathers. Just to continue with the story of where we are, so the Malay community from Indonesia, they were in Cape Town, as we said, around the 1700s. It took another 150 years before we found our Indian brothers and sisters from the subcontinent being brought from England by the English now to the eastern side of South Africa. And now we have, you know, great people like Sheikh Ahmad Didat, that's more Hanafi orientated. They are brought to the eastern side of South Africa more as business people and people that would work on the plantations, more skilled people, and they set up their own kind of Muslim community, and therefore you have a very diverse mix of Muslims here. The Malays were more Shafi inclined, and whereas our Indian brothers are more Hanafi inclined. Well, alhamdulillah, we realized that, look, there's no time for us to fight over these things. We have a much bigger problem. We are being subjugated by an oppressor. They don't care what kind of Muslim you are. For you, you're a Mohammedan. You are a infidel. That's all they see you as. You need to come together as one community and work together. And that is the objective. And of course, the next big challenge the Muslims of this land would face after the end of the colonizers left, but what they left behind was something as bad or even worse in some regard, is apartheid. Many of you were not familiar with it. When the colonizers stepped out, the people that remained of European ethnicity, or the white people of South Africa, not all of them, a group of them, the Afrikaners, they established this policy of the apartheid government for about 50 years, which saw that it demarcated people based on their race and their color. So if you are a white person, you are on the higher end of the spectrum and you got all the privileges. You could attend a university, your kids got to go to certain schools. You got all the privileges, the posh, beautiful areas of the country will belong to you. And as your skin became darker, as your pigmentation got darker, the rights you had got less and less and less. And therefore, our African brothers, they got the worst. Their kids couldn't go to school. They couldn't live even in the cities. They lived in squatter camps, in homelands, and today that legacy is still here. Many of them are still living in those horrible conditions because it takes a long time to undo this. And the Muslim sort of the Indians and the Malay Muslims, kind of in the middle, had some privileges, but of course were also very much affected by this law. Islam was also not favorably seen by the government because a big part of the apartheid government, they had a very strong Christian link. And so you had prohibition of marriages, for example. Our marriages were not recognized. Between the nikahs that we had were not recognized. A certain terrible act, which is called the Group Areas Act. People were forced out of certain areas. So they would designate this area is an area only for white people. Now, if you are a Muslim, Indian Muslim, Malay Muslim living there, what does that mean? This land has now become a whites only area. Well, you had to pack up and leave. And your house was taken from you, your business. Many of the people at the time, they were tradesmen. They would have, you know, a tailoring business, or they would have a shop. This would be taken from you, and you would be dumped in a certain area. And pass laws, meaning people that weren't white weren't allowed to move. They were under confinement, curfew. You only could move with permission. Public transport was only for a certain group of people could use public transport. This is the most, you know, advanced or the most cruel form of racism that the world has ever seen. No country in the world has racism as, you know, as profound as the apartheid government here in South Africa. And so the question is, how did Islam survive under that? People couldn't even learn secular knowledge correctly. The same way it survived and thrived throughout the years of oppression, it was each home and neighbor looking after one another. Kids would go to the imam, sometimes in the living room, sometimes if you could in the masjid. You would learn what you could of Islamic knowledge. The father of the house would ensure that everyone is performing their salah. On Thursday nights, whether you agree or disagree, they would get together and they would recite Surah Yasin, they would recite certain adhkar to in keep this tradition going, as was done for the past 200-300 years. And there were certain things, I'm a Muslim, whatever the government says, when it's Jumu'ah time, I won't be working, I will leave school and I will come to the mosque to perform Jumu'ah. One of the most amazing things about the Muslim community during this period was, even though certain land, certain areas, there's a suburb called District 6 here in Cape Town, which is a very proud and prominent Muslim community, the people were taken completely away. Their homes, their businesses were demolished. Inside that community, there were three mosques. Until today, those three masajid have survived. So all the homes have been demolished. The Muslim community, even though they left that area, they made sure the masjid will remain. And this is a very powerful message for us. We are now in isolation. We might still live next to the masjid, but I'm not attending the masjid. It doesn't mean that the masjid doesn't have an amana upon us. We still have a duty, a responsibility to ensure the honor, the sanctity of the masjid is upheld. And these people, you know, these are our grandparents now. We're talking about my grandparents lived in the suburb. They got pushed out, but there was still an effort to say our old mosques in those areas will be maintained and we will establish new ones in the new areas. And we would start from scratch, if so be it, all the way from the beginning. And that's what they did. The community had to reinvent itself, and it did so during this period. With all the difficulties, with the lack of opportunities, the Islam continued to survive and continued to teach the next generation that this is what our deen is all about. What is also something we're very proud of is the resistance to apartheid. Of course, there was a movement, the ANC, the most famous. There were many, many people that they opposed apartheid. What we are very proud of is that Muslims were of the very first people to join this organization and join the fight against apartheid. We are a very small minority, maybe 1%, 2% ethnically of this country. But we saw that this was not a white, black, two non-Muslim communities fighting each other. This was oppression and injustice, and we are on the side of the oppressed. Our deen doesn't look at color. Our deen looks at the right and wrong, and as Muslims, we should always be on the side of the right. This virus, for example, it's a global pandemic. It affects all of us. We as Muslims should always take the side of what is right for the benefit of humanity. And of the, very proudly, of the founding fathers, one of the leading members of the ANC, when Nelson Mandela was sent to prison, he didn't get sent alone. Him, along with six other chief members of the ANC, were in prison. One of them is our recently deceased brother Ahmed Kathrada, rahimahullah, Allah grant him a high place in Jannah. He was of those early Muslims that were imprisoned in Robben Island along with Nelson Mandela. And there was a deep respect that was between the ANC leadership and Islam, because as Muslims, we basically shown that we have a long track record of fighting oppression in this land from the awliya that came right at the beginning of colonization. We've always been fighting the oppressor, and we've always been on the side of uplifting the oppressed, irrespective of color and irrespective of religion even. Something from a personal side note, the Muslims that were, Nelson Mandela included, imprisoned in Robben Island, the Imam, the previous Imam of Masjid Boorhaanol Islam, Imam Abdurrahman Basir, Omani Basir as he's called here, he had the privilege of being allowed to be a chaplain to the prison. So on a monthly basis, he would be allowed the to visit Robben Island and visit the Muslim prisoners to see how they were doing. But of course, the prisoners were so excited to see a friendly face that even the non-Muslims, including Nelson Mandela, they would sit in his company and he would give them words of advice, words of comfort. And therefore, there's a deep respect from an Islamic, you know, for Islam, and the Muslim community was developed. And it's one of the reasons why, alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, and one of the reasons why, alhamdulillah, Islam has a very favorable position here in South Africa now, is that we are part of the political, economical, social issues of the country. We don't only look at Muslim issues, we look at the country's issues. And many of our Muslim brothers in Europe, in America, in Australia, trying to integrate with their society, you don't have to let go of your Islam. In fact, you as a Muslim and your principles and the ideals Islam teaches you is what, you know, your country needs. It is, you will be part of the change that is positive in your nation. And that is one of the things that we learn from our founding fathers here, that we've always been part of the struggle, whatever it might have been. And alhamdulillah, 1994 is a great year for us. That is when apartheid finally comes to an end after basically 50 years of oppression, and we live in a free South Africa. And it's been like that for now about 30 years of we could say in 2024 would have been 30 years of a free South Africa. This is the current president Cyril Ramaphosa. Just another interesting anecdote, something I have never seen in my life. I don't think many people have seen. When he became the president about 2 years ago, he was invited to an iftar. And he was invited by the Muslim community at the beginning of Ramadan to come for an iftar. And he honored that invitation. And he came, he not only joined us for iftar, I was there, alhamdulillah, he actually joined us in Maghrib Salah. And he performed the Salah, he fell in sujood and ruku. And we prayed that, alhamdulillah, someone that, you know, whether it is for political points, you know, anyone who has made sajda for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah guide him, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide everyone to the haqq and to the truth. That kind of respect shown by a leader, for us as a 1% community, our vote counts very little. We always say, you know, if all of us vote together, we only, you know, can fill one seat in parliament. Our vote doesn't count too much, but our voice, alhamdulillah, is respected. And alhamdulillah, it has a position here in this community by the grace of Allah, but also by the efforts made by these great people. Now I take you back, think of Sheikh Yusuf when he came here trying to keep his community reciting Alif Bata, you know, in the middle of nowhere on a farm outside Cape Town. And then Sheikh Tuanguru fighting his whole life to build a masjid. Could he have imagined we would be where we are now, sitting on in parliament, sitting on the executive committee of some of the biggest companies in this country? So this story of the Muslims here in the South, the heroes of the South, we've gone from exiles to slavery, through colonization, through apartheid, we've maintained our Islam, maintained our identity. It stood the test of time by the grace of Allah, and we've continuously contributed. If I go through some of the benchmarks here, we have over 1,000 mosques in South Africa, 200 plus 300, this was an old presentation, and more than 300 here in Cape Town, countless schools, madrasas, halal authorized certifying bodies. You can go to any shop and you'd find that stamp there, it is halal. I've traveled the world, alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah. I've seen many lands. You go to a certain restaurant, you don't know if it's halal. You have to basically say, brother, do you have any alcohol? Alcohol is a given, it's going to be on the menu. Do you have any pork? Can you put my food aside? Alhamdulillah, you can walk in, you look at that stamp, is it halal? It's halal, jazakallah. I can sit here. If not, I walk out, I go to the place next door. You are spoiled with choice. You are spoiled with opportunity. You never have to compromise. Do I have to be, you know... I work at an international company, a retail company. This is how I come to work most Fridays and many days of the week. I come with a thobe, with a fez. I sit in the board meetings with our directors, alhamdulillah, like this. And it is, no one gives you a second look. It is part and parcel of the culture of what it is in this community. We have a salah facility at my company. We do fully salah. In fact, when this restrictions came down, there were too many people in the salah facility, had to be closed down like any other places of worship. We have zakah, you know, authorizing bodies, many of the big zakah institutions in the world, in Canada, in New Zealand, in Australia. They modeled themselves on SANZAF here in South Africa. One of the first people to in the Western world to start a zakah institution. Again, where did we start? Far away from the central hub of Islamic learning and institutions. And it was
very simple, basic people who could hardly read or write, but they knew the basics of their deen and they practiced it sincerely and they taught it onto the next generation. They knew Friday is a holy day. We're not going to do haram as best we can. We will recite Quran. The mosque is a holy place. We'll go and visit. We'll attend the mosque at least, you know, once a week or a few times a week. Kids, you need to know these things. This is what is your aura. This is what you can eat, can't eat. This is how you clean yourselves. And the basics were taught and then practiced. And so, alhamdulillah, we've seen this community grow. Many celebrities and famous people proudly, you know, showing their Islam. Judges, lawyers, business people, of the wealthiest people here, alhamdulillah, are from this community. And we've contributed so much. But we are only products of these pioneering heroes that through very, very difficult times, you know, planted those seeds, protected those seeds, watered those seeds, not knowing what it would become, hoping for the best, fearing that it would, you know, disappear, that this community would have disappeared, you know, through that, through the end of time. But subhanAllah, it's thrived and it's now on the, you know, one of the one of the most respected Muslim minorities in the world. In closing, for you and me, we are now the next chapter of this community. We don't know how the story ends, and that is for Allah to decide. But we are now, it's our time, we are writing this chapter. And it's going to be, what do we want our generation, you know, the generations afterwards to say about us? We have a lot more opportunities for the Muslims, in particular in South Africa, than any other generation before us. There was no Muslim community in the history of South Africa that had the freedoms and opportunities like we do right now. And what do we do with that? And on top of that, of course, we are now being confronted with a new kind of difficulty, this virus. And one thing that we should remember is our ancestors always kept the Islam first and foremost, and then they were a force for positive change in their communities. This formula works. Be a strong, practicing Muslim. Do the basics right. You don't have to be an alim. You don't have to be the most learned person. You just have to be a strong, practicing. This is my identity as a Muslim. I do the basics well. But also, I'm a good neighbor. I'm a good employee in a company. I support my community. If someone is in need, our door is always open. If you want something, you want something to eat, there's always enough for someone more. This area where the masjid is called Boorhaanol Islam Masjid. Alhamdulillah. I've lived in Saudi Arabia. I've had many Ramadans in Mecca and in Medina. Some of the best memories. But the Ramadan you feel in the Boorhaanol is something. It's something very, very special. It is that traditional, like you almost imagine the Sahaba. You find people that have nothing, students that are studying away from home, people that have, you know, lost a wife, bachelors, you know, old men that just they alone living in a house, refugees, and they'll come to the masjid and they will find in the masjid a sanctuary, a place where they can break their fast, they can stand together, can pull the salah. Of the most beautiful things I've seen is in this community, which is really that essence of Islam. When you come to the Boorhaanol, for example, there's, you know, the houses are painted very beautifully, the mosques are there. The culture of Boorhaanol is not about its buildings and its mosques. It is about the sunnah, little bits of the sunnah that is still there. Respect for your elders, neighborliness, kids, you know, wearing Islamic attire. This kind of Islam that you see alive, this is what makes the Boorhaanol beautiful. And this is what makes our community beautiful. And so every single Muslim throughout the world, and particularly here in South Africa, we are ambassadors of this deen. And it is our opportunity to leave a legacy, our own legacy, to leave our mark, to be the next heroes. Remember, heroes are not, they are not people that should be in comic books. And heroes are not also meant to be in history books. Heroes are alive now. And each and every one of us, inshallah, need to take our seat, our place in history, and to do something beneficial for our community, inshallah, bi-ibnillah. And I pray, inshallah, that through the series, if this is the last one, it's coming up to Ramadan, then I hope that it has given you some kind of comfort, that even the best of people go through hardships. Sometimes it is because that they are the best, Allah tests them. And Allah wants us, no matter how difficult things are, to arise above these challenges, to show that we are better than this, and that we contribute something positive. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you, make me, make our families, protect us, and make us mediums of change and success. May we get through this hardest hour, and inshallah, may Allah grant us to be better people at the end of it. May Allah bless you and bless all of us. Ameen. Jazakallah khair. Thank you so much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.